This is Primary Duty, the Forging of Luke Stone series, Book 6, written by Jack Mars, narrated by Larry Gorman. Chapter 1. September 21st, 2006. 8:15 a.m. Central European Summer Time. 2:15 a.m. Eastern Daylight Time. La Canada Real, Coslada, Madrid, Spain. "Where is he now?" Jafar Adrisi said. The two men made their way together along the bleak alleys between the tumble-down wood and cement dwellings of the largest shantytown in Europe. The morning was cold and overcast, and a chill ran up Jafar's back, despite his windbreaker jacket and the sweater he wore underneath. It had rained last night, and fetid puddles of brown water remained in the pitted earth of the walking path. These people had neither electricity nor running water in their homes. The two men walked through this hellish compound, not because they lived here, but because it was a good place to talk and not be overheard. The residents here were too hopeless to concern themselves with the talk of others, and the police rarely bothered to make their way through this maze of despair. Up ahead, a group of children were playing on three makeshift slides. The slides were made of what appeared to be large PVC plastic pipes, cut in half lengthwise. The pipes were pitched up against a mound of dirt and junk. At the top was a pile of discarded car and truck tires that the children climbed up to enter the mouth of each tube. At the bottom was a mound of sand trucked in from somewhere. The sand had become a thick yellow muck from the rain. It was a disgrace of a playground. Things of this nature, a mere 20 kilometers from the center of Madrid, the wealthiest city in the country, that global hub of media, fashion, education, entertainment, sport, and government, tended to raise the anger within Jafar. Was it so hard? Would it be such a terrible challenge to give the children of the poor and despised something worth having? This shantytown, this so-called illegal settlement, was home to thousands of Romani gypsies and new Moroccan immigrants, the wretched of Spain. And it showed. "He is in Barcelona," the young man walking with Jafar said. "He is staying at the Hotel Arts." Jafar shrugged. "And what makes this of interest to me?" Jafar was 41 years old. Beginning 3 years before, he had been the originator and primary planner of an idea so outrageous that even he didn't believe in it at first. The idea was to plant rucksack bombs on commuter trains headed to the Atocha station, the central train station of Madrid. It was a success beyond all expectation. The attacks in March of 2004 killed 194 people and injured more than 2,000. It spread terror throughout the country and all of Europe. Four participants in the attack killed themselves as the police closed in on them. Two of those were the only men who knew of Jafar's involvement. 21 other men went to prison, likely for the rest of their lives. Jafar dreamed of the event. Jafar planned the event. And when the time came to drink of the poison cup resulting from the event, Allah himself took the cup away from Jafar's lips and left him free to do it again. Jafar shook his head, almost in disbelief. He was among the blessed, and even now remained hidden from the eyes of the enemy. He seemed to be an aging ex-convict, a man who had spent 13 years in foul Spanish prisons for the trafficking of hashish from Morocco. He seemed to be a cast-off, a man who lived in a two-bedroom flat on the 18th floor of a high-rise, one in an endless parade of identical high-rises. He seemed to share that tiny flat with his mother, his young wife, their infant son, and his 9-year-old niece, the child of his drug-addicted prostitute of a sister. In fact, all of these things were true. His existence seemed anonymous, pointless. Just another throwaway, impoverished immigrant who had done prison time and had come out older but no wiser. The energy of his youth dissipated, his prospects for the future grim. This was him, and it also wasn't. He had masterminded the largest terror attack in Europe in decades and hadn't been caught or suspected. He hadn't even been questioned. Hundreds of men had been brought in for interrogation, but not Jafar. He was too old. He was broken by prison. He couldn't have been involved. A miracle had occurred. A message from Allah had been sent and had been received. "You have been chosen." He stopped walking for a moment and looked at the younger man. In a sense, this man was a messenger as well. He was bringing a different kind of message, but it might also come from Allah. Jafar was highly attuned to this possibility. Hotels, guest houses, restaurants, and taverns were staffed by.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.